Hi, Professor. This is Chris Chard. Here's my ID for you. And today I'm going to talk about my research topic, which was class action lawsuits. I started off my paper by discussing how the attitudes of the court have changed to better adapt to society at that point in time. For example, I read a lot about in the text about the Industrial Revolution, how the court systems were constantly adapting their laws to better, like, whatever they could do to help businesses continue to produce heavily and, again, make jobs happen and everything like that. The thing is, when it came to people, employment contracts, when people were actually working in those factories at the time, businesses put clauses in their contracts that pretty much protected them against anything that workers could charge them with or try to sue them for. So pretty much joining a class to attack a business. Basically, at the time, they could put anything in their contracts to protect themselves from being sued, I guess, or a class action being put on them. But again, the court was in the mindset at the time was that these factories, these operations were bettering the economy, bettering public policy, bettering society as a whole. So they backed off a little bit and they focused more on the business during the Industrial Revolution instead of an actual individual working there. So it's one of those things I just kind of want to emphasize how important it was. I mean, just at the time and but again, and just how laissez-faire had a big influence on like court decisions and how they wanted to stay out of the area at the time, pretty much stay away from businesses and let them do what they want to do. So again, they could. Businesses could put anything they wanted in the contracts, and then the law, the court would interpret you entered at your own risk. It's like it was, and again, those factors were dangerous. People were dying, people were getting disease, and again, everybody was contributing pretty much to their own negligence if they ever just they assumed the risk of actually working there. So again, it's interesting to see how the court's attitudes have shifted as the time has carried on. So again, when the Industrial Revolution started to wane a little bit, courts decided to start focusing more on protecting individual rights instead of the actual business. So the attitudes quickly changed. Again, and to start off, the basis of a class action lawsuits is it's a class of people that are pretty much going after one defendant that has wronged them. In this day and age, it's usually a massive corporation. To start off, the requirements that in order to bring class action lawsuits are numerosity, which means that pretty much you couldn't bring an entire court of 1,000 people that wanted to sue a defendant together. It just wouldn't be able to happen. So you just have to have a certain amount of representatives represent the case. Commonality. There's basically just a, there's a question of law common to the class, pretty much, of that they were wrong by the defendant. And typicality, which means representatives share the same claims. Quality was then pretty much just shown direct harm by the defendant. Adequacy means that the representatives of the class will do the best they can to protect the interests of the individuals of the class that were harmed. So again, it's just like you can't have 1,000 individuals up there. You have to pretty much be able to pick your own individuals. And again, the court systems are going to want to weigh every bit of factor like that when they're actually conducting this trial. So one thing about that I wanted to mention is attorneys are aware of the money that can stem from all this. They are aware of how much they can win or how much they can pretty much be compensated for if they are to win a case like this. So some of the things that it needs to be kind of adapted a little bit because looks like in 2005 there was a Class Action Fairness Act which kind of helped to limit the compensation of the lawyers and focus more on actually the individuals that were directly harmed by whatever product or whatever the defendant did, and it's just less emphasis on the lawyer. So that was pretty good to read about. Let's see. Anyway, there are many positive things associated with class action lawsuits is lower litigation costs. If you have a bunch of people going and suing a defendant, it's the low, like pretty much it's split up. It's not like one major cost for one individual. So it really helps corporations budget for things like this. They budget for, they're aware of the possibility of them getting sued. So they're prepared to budget as much as they want to decide for this, which makes it very unfair for an individual who's not a millionaire to even go up against these big corporations. The efficiency of the court system was another thing that I read about. It's just usually one judge in one court, and sometimes it can make the process a little bit quicker. And again, sometimes it stems for a long time, but nice thing too is there's, if you just have 1,000 individuals or whatever suing for one cause and it's not individual cases, there's more there's less inconsistencies to happen. Like it's just less repetition and less forms of inconsistencies that could come from a verdict. Let's see. And another thing is every member of the class is usually able to be compensated by the injury that they sustain, whether it's a small injury or a big one. Let's see. So some of the negatives, though. If you got 100 people that were directly harmed by the defendant, this can pretty much pose a huge problem when it comes to individuals being adequately represented. If they want control of the case, they'd have to go at it individually from an individual case basis. They're not going to be able to. If you're not picked as a representative of the class, you pretty much have no say. The lawyer and the people that represented you have the say. So that's kind of hard to deal with sometimes. Individual members may prefer just to, they want to represent themselves with their lawyer. So I figured that individuals that have been severely injured should be the key candidates for people representing the class, just because of the if you can prove that injury was greater than others, it's like the likelihood of you being compensated is pretty high. Let's see. And again, when an individual joins a class action lawsuit, they give up the right to be able to go at it individually later. So that's one thing people should really think about. So that's definitely a negative. Let's see. One thing that I wanted to touch upon is some of the ridiculous natures of some class action lawsuits that have really kind of made me question like the point of it all. Again, I've read an article about how somebody filed a class action lawsuit of against Dunkin' Donuts because they were given fake butter instead of real butter. It's just really ridiculous. And then there's, I think I want to remember that. I think McDonald's has been sued a couple times because they didn't put that their coffee was hot on a coffee cup or whatever. It's just one of those things. It's just absolutely ridiculous. And that's the point you were trying to make, that how society is so litigious, or I guess what's the word for it? They want to sue pretty much anything they can. Then again, there is very important aspects of it for class action lawsuits. For example, what I really targeted was pharmaceutical products and how they can pose direct harms for people. And again, it's hard for an individual to sue a massive corporation such as a pharmaceutical industry. It's just not going to happen. It's going to drag out forever, and the individual pretty much will go bankrupt. Again, these companies budget for this, so. But yeah, there was a drug called Zofran that I researched a little bit, and it was treated for people that had chemotherapy or, or a recent surgery. So they were vomiting. They just were sick from it. However, the company, GlaxoSmithKline, they advocated for Zofran, and they tried to market it as much as they could to get doctors to prescribe it to women that had morning sickness from pregnancies. So what happened was when they took it, babies were born with deformities, heart defects, mouth defects, skeletal irregularities. So it was hard to, it was a lot of things happened to the child, and they blame it directly on Zofran. The FDA approved the drug, so the drug wasn't the problem. It was that GlaxoSmithKline was pretty much off-label. It was for being blamed for off-label uses. It was never intended to be used for people that had morning sickness. It was to be used for cancer patients or people that just had surgery. So they were accused of off-labeling. And again, it was one of the things. It was one of the biggest lawsuits in the history of the healthcare industry. GlaxoSmithKline paid a ton of money because of it. So it's very important that, again, a class action lawsuit is there, just because, again, if your child is deformed because of a drug that the mother was taking, they should be directly responsible for that off-labeling. It's ridiculous that they wouldn't be. And again, there's possibility that they might not be liable if nobody has the money to sue them. So, I mean, it's just very important that's one of the reasons that class action lawsuits are very important. Also, I wanted to touch upon arbitration hearings. Arbitration is a form of just being able to get away from the court systems and being able to resolve disputes outside of the court through individual arbitrators. So businesses mostly put those in their employment contracts, and just to protect themselves from being involved in class action lawsuits related to arbitration. Class action lawsuits just in general, again, if they put those in their contracts, if they're able to put arbitration clauses in their contracts, arbitration agreements that employees actually agree to when they're signing on, they are free from pretty much anything. They're not going to be able to take, the individuals that were harmed are not going to be able to take the company to a class action lawsuit. It'll just be usually solved through arbitration. An example of this was Ernst & Young versus Morris. I researched about. It sounds like Morris was not compensated for his overtime pay, and he took it out on a class action lawsuit. And again, the courts were forced to enforce the arbitration agreement because it was direct in the clause and the employee agreed to it. So it's just one of the things that really people need to consider before they're signing on something. If they're not agreeing to these terms, don't sign the paper, pretty much, because you're pretty much stuck with an arbitration case. Last but not least, though, just in conclusion, class action lawsuits are incredibly important. Again, if you have major corporations that you want to sue but you can't sue because you don't have the money to do it, you put a class together and you try to get some money and you try to sue them. And again, it's one of those things where hopefully that defendant would be directly responsible for something major, not something like butter or coffee or something like that, which I just thought was just absolutely ridiculous. But again, they're very important to have for, as long as you're not taking advantage of them, in my opinion. I mean, the court system is there for a reason, and it's not to settle disputes over ridiculous things like butter or coffee. I thought that was, again, it just struck me as ridiculous. Unfortunately, in the foreseeable future, contracts begin to get more complex, so class action lawsuits may begin to dwindle a little bit because businesses are always going to be trying to put something in their contracts to protect them, even if you're buying something. I mean, we did an article about, we did something about T-Mobile and how there was an arbitration clause in the contract that protected T-Mobile from going to a class action lawsuit if the individual signed the arbitration agreement, which that individual did, and was stuck with an arbitration. Like, they don't have a choice but to enforce that. The courts don't have a choice but to enforce that if it's in the contract. But hopefully they will remain present for the foreseeable future, because it's sometimes the only sign that justice can really be served. Other than that, I enjoyed very much researching about it. If you got any questions, please let me know. Thank you.